the lions talk. The Bible said there's a lion asleep in Judah. Who will wake him? No pussycat can wake up a lion. And this pussycat leadership will never wake the black man up. You're too weak in your effort to free our people from the hand of the oppressor.
Islam. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So we can really start like that. We're going to always start in the name of Allah, but this, you know, it's taking us right where we want to be. Mm-hmm. Segue right where we want to be, where you have what you just said about the Mohammedans. Mm-hmm. There's a religion. We want to deal with, you know, that sect of conscious people. Mm-hmm. And that's the Moorish American.
Okay.
So we're not going to stick and stay on the Moorish Americans, because of course you know they are brothers.
Right.
The Ottoman Minister Louis Farrakhan, you know, we in the Nation of Islam, under his guidance, we honor, the Honorable Noble Drew Ali, right. The Honorable Marcus Garvey, mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So we're going to deal with the conscious community. Even the Hebrew Israelites, I ran into one last week on 56 in Market, and I was telling the brother, I said, brother, I learned a lot from y'all.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean? Because one good thing about being free is when you're not stuck under one umbrella, you mm-hmm. know what I mean? Or one tent mm-hmm. of wisdom and knowledge, you know what I mean? You got a tabernacle here that you just made and you stuck under that.
Mm-hmm.
But God is universal.
Right.
He's a God of all the worlds, not just one.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, when we speak the language of the people, well, when Elijah Muhammad teaches us that, in our supreme wisdom to speak the language of the people, well, how many languages is on the planet? That's how many languages you have to be able to speak. And the language is not just dealing with Spanish, French, or Italian, or anything like that. It's dealing with your religious language, your way of worship. So when God gives you that one truth, when you speak it with the good, with the right heart, you can experience what the apostles experienced in the book of Acts. On the day of Pentecost at Antioch, they spoke a truth and everybody heard that truth in their own language or spiritual tongue.
Mm-hmm.
See what I'm saying? And then that's when they got those 5,000 converts at a time.
Mm.
And that's the kind of language that we're going to talk about today. Because that language only comes from the teachings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad as taught by the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. So we're going to get into that. But we're going to start off giving the praise to the one God whom all praise is due and whom all praise belongs to. So in the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, I bear witness that there is no God but Allah, and I bear witness that Muhammad is his messenger. And I further bear witness that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad today, under the guidance of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, is our guide in this day, 1400 years after the last prophet, which is Muhammad. Mm-hmm. So it's in their names that I greet you. In the Nation of Islam's greeting words of peace, Brother Kyle, and our viewers and listeners, Assalamu alaikum.
Walaikum assalam, bro.
Yes, sir. So we can get right into that, man, and we're dealing with the conscious community today. Mm-hmm. Yup. But that's the type of language we're trying to get into right now. Mm-hmm. We want to get into that the meaning of, you know, the day of Pentecost at Antioch. What is the tongues that we should be speaking in? Because, of course, you know, our Christian brothers say the tongue speaking is when you're speaking a language that nobody knows what it means, but it's more like a feeling, see? And a lot of times, since we're not Marvin Gaye, that feeling can lead you astray. When you put feeling into your religion, so much feeling that you have no logic. Mm. You know what I mean? Now you're just rolling with something that they call faith, but I like to call what it is. Blind faith. It's not the evidence of the things hoped for, or the, like it says in the book of Hebrews, about what real faith is, the substance of the things hoped for, evidence of the things unseen, right? Well, if you look at those two words, evidence, if I drop this comb, right, that's evidence that something is going on between my hand and the floor. And that's something that I can't see. It's called gravity. Right. But the evidence is what took place. You see what I'm saying? So you believing in the unseen, but you got evidence that whatever is present that you can't see is real. Mm-hmm. So it is with God. You can't see God, but you're looking at me. So I'm the evidence. Mm-hmm. That there's a life-giving God that breathes life into the human being. And now I'm moving, showing the evidence of a God that's unseen. Did you say unseen in the Nation of Islam? Well, yes, I did. Because we believe, like the Holy Quran says, fulfilling the scriptures of the Holy Prophet, that we believe in the seen and the unseen, so we have a full and complete Islam. Mm-hmm. And a full and complete understanding. You can't believe in one without the other. I mean, this is what's taught by the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. You must believe in both.
Right.
You cannot believe in one. So that's the problem with the religious scholars of the world. They believe in the unseen when you're dealing with divinity and when you're dealing with Allah. Mm-hmm. But then they don't connect the unseen to what you can see. Mm-hmm. See what I'm saying? So now you don't have any substance. Mm-hmm. See?
Right.
The substance of the things hoped for. So you end up with a faith like I was, this is what I was driving at, or driving to. You end up with a faith that you can't see. So they call that what? Blind faith. See, that's when you're wrapped up in these feelings now. Feelings is really steeped in blind faith. Know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So your whole misunderstanding is based on your emotions. That's the point that I'm making. Mm-hmm. And that's why you can have traditions of men that you stick to regardless of the logic of that teaching. My mother did it, my father did it, I'm gonna still do it myself. Mm-hmm. So now you eating pork, you got Christmas trees and all of these silly things, you can't find none of it in the scriptures. But this is what you mean, you're laboring under this type of falsehood, so.
How does a person deal with those emotions?
Well, again, you have to be a person who learns how to love truth. Mm-hmm. When you learn truth, you can't deal with emotion that's just connected to nothing. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Foundationless emotions. It's like going to church and you're hearing the music, and the music gets you all excited and you feel like God is in the house. We're a very musical, rhythmic group of people, mm-hmm. the original people. So when they, incorporate that music and you all excited and you connect that to God himself, now you more stuck on music than you are the word of God. Mm-hmm. The logic and the power of the word of God.
Right.
you're not even getting that part of it. You're only getting stuck on the emotional side of it. So you're losing all kind of, you know, connections that God is trying to connect you to. Mm-hmm. We are supposed to be connected to God through truth, not through a song. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? We're supposed to be connected to God through truth, not emotion. Mm-hmm. Not that the truth won't get you emotional. Mm-hmm. The truth will get you emotional. That's why it says that Jesus turned the water into wine at the wedding. Whose wedding? Our wedding to God. Because he gives a deep understanding of the word of God. So mm-hmm. it goes right back to interpretation. Mm-hmm. Like it says in the Holy Quran, not the Holy Quran, our final call. And we're going to do one on that very, very soon. What the Muslims believe coming up soon. Mm-hmm. You know, we believe in the Bible, but we believe it's been tampered with and must be reinterpreted so man won't be snared by the falsehoods that's been added to it. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
So this is something that really needs to be looked at. So the water being turned into wine, when you have a watered down understanding of the word, you can get a benefit from the water, because what water does is it purifies you, cleans you out. But if all you drinking is water with no nutritional value, because there is no nutritional value in water, you'll die just drinking water. No nutritional value, no vitamins, no minerals, no nothing. You know what I mean? That the body needs to live. You drink water long enough, and if that's all you're doing, you will die. And if you have a watered down understanding of God, you will die spiritually.
Spiritual death.
Yes. And the marriage can't be what it should be until a man like Christ comes into the world, a man with wisdom, and this man has knowledge and a deep understanding and a deep interpretation that comes from God himself. So when that wise man waves his hand over dead letter scripture and gives it meaning, right, then you understand that you're not reading about a snake that got legs, that can talk, mm-hmm. that's influencing Eve over God himself. Mm-hmm. When you read it like that, it's like reading water. You can't put that together for yourself. Mm-hmm. Because our earthly minds, we feel like what we used to. We're used to women being afraid of a mouse. Mm-hmm. So if she's going to run from a mouse, what would make us think that she's going to sit there and talk to a walking, talking snake? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So there's a watered down understanding. You have this strong respect for God. You know, and I definitely don't want to make this too long, but I have to say it, you know, wisdom and knowledge is deep. It's connected to so many different things, but I want to make it very short. You have this respect for God. So when you're reading the word of God with respect, of course, you're going to purify your soul. But can you really get anything out of the story with the wrong interpretation that a woman is talking to a serpent that had legs, and this serpent convinces her to go against God, and because of that, the punishment goes to the serpent. He loses his legs, and his punishment is to eat dust, dust all the days of his life. What does these things mean? These are symbolic language that has meaning behind it.
Yeah. How can that help you?
Exactly. Yeah. But when you know that serpent is a man, mm-hmm. see, that's the spark now. It makes you want to. You get a spark from the right interpretation and the right understanding, makes you want to go back and say, hold up, let me look at this under this perspective.
Right.
That the serpent is a low-life man. Mm-hmm. You know? But that's why I said we don't want to go in that direction too far.
Yeah.
Right, and too long.
Well, tell me what was on your mind, because we were talking about, you know, like, all right, the Moore Science Temple, our brothers.
Right.
They have a perspective on color.
Right.
Well, we should say a misunderstanding. The Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad gave us an understanding of what it means to be black.
Right.
Truly. So, what did the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad say? And then why do you think it's hard for people to wrap their mind around the concept of blackness as he taught? Or are people having trouble understanding that?
Well, the only problem, Brother Kyle, that people are having mm-hmm. is the conscious community. That's their problem.
Okay.
The conscious community being so confusing, they use their influence to confuse instead of teach. Sometimes it comes from arrogance. Sometimes it comes from jealousy. They might not like the way our group may be pulling the people and we're receiving the numbers that we receive. Because Jesus in the Bible talked to the multitudes, and there's only one person that can speak to the multitudes today, and that's the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. So a lot of times they have this gang mentality where they don't like the fact that they don't have a leader, number one, that's alive. Mm-hmm. And number two, if you do have somebody alive, he's not as influential as our minister. But our minister is more than just influential. Our minister is the Holy Spirit of God. And that's the reason he can do these miraculous things, like call for a million men to show up and almost 2 million show up. This is not the minister, like he said. This is not my day. This is not something that I did. This day belongs to Allah, God himself. And he gave all praise to due to God for the million man march. All of them. And they were all successful because he is the man right now. And see, we have the exact same religion as Jesus himself. I'm saying when you read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we were talking, me and one of my customers, Reese, today. I said there's no other group or no other religion that can claim having the exact religion as Moses, the same religion as Noah and Jesus and the prophets. And of course, the Holy Prophet. Peace and blessings be upon all of them. But why can't they say that? Because they can say it, but they can't prove it. We're saying it, we can prove it. And we prove it because if you read the gospel, you'll see Jesus teaching about a true and living God. A true and living God that sent him into the world. What are we teaching? That we follow the true and living God that sent our man into the world and raised up a man that was likened to himself. Master Far Muhammad reproduced himself, right? Through the Honorable Minister, the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And then the Honorable Elijah Muhammad reproduced himself through the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Now, here's the thing I want to say, and I'm going to try to get back to what the question was. See, baptism, according to the scriptures, you're baptized in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. But look at what's being said, the name of the Father. Well, what's the Father's name? Baptized in the name of the Son. What's the Son's name? Okay, people say Jesus. And in the name of the Holy Spirit, what's the Holy Spirit's name? Now, every time we speak, for the most part, you come to the mosque, mosque number 12, how do we open up? We open up with not only a greeting, we open up with not only a prayer, but we open up literally with baptism. You're baptizing the listeners in the name of the Father who came in the person of Master Farid Muhammad, and in the name of the Son, the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and in the name of the Holy Spirit in living flesh, that's the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, and we say in their names, we greet you in the Nation of Islam by giving you the Nation of Islam's greeting words of peace, assalamu alaikum, and we open up like that, and this is what we do every Sunday and almost every time we speak. Of course, when we have the time, and then when we try to be mindful of the time, we open up with Shahada, right? So we say we believe, you know, in the name of Allah, beneficent, merciful. Or we there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is His messenger, Shahada. But for the most part, we put our people through a form of baptism. You know, So when it comes back to this conscious community, it's not the people, Kyle. That's what I'm saying. It's not the people that's confused. It's the conscious community that's confusing the people. This is not hard to understand. So now we end up with little small details where we're trying to take the people who are responsible for setting up our group and putting these people over top of everybody else's person. But one thing about black people, just like scripture, we are God's people. We didn't set anything up. What we had was set up by God. One from the east came over here to the west. Mm-hmm. And scriptures was fulfilled when one without letters, one who was not learned, mm-hmm. one who went to the third grade of school, yeah. was raised up by a stranger mm-hmm. that came from a whole nother place
right.
that was so much more holy than the place that we're at.
Yeah.
We dress different. We worship different.
Mm-hmm. You know, ate different.
We ate different. Yeah. So here's a man that literally left paradise, a physical paradise, which was Mecca, mm-hmm. one of the cleanest places we have, left the holy lands in the east and came over here to the west, Matthew 24, verse 27, and raised up one, just like Moses was lifted up. You know, so shall the Son of Man be lifted up. No, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so will the Son of Man be lifted up. And that's a deep scripture, because now you're saying, wait a minute, you're trying to call the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad a serpent? Well, the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad was living a serpent-like life. Like me and you and all of us before God, who came in the person of Master Prophet Muhammad and lifted up the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. So this is something that's going on that's being fueled by a higher power. Not fueled by us, but fueled by God. So there's no arrogance with the formation of what we call Nation of Islam. You say, well, is it arrogance with other religions? Well, it didn't start off arrogantly. Mm-hmm. Buddha wasn't arrogant, but the people that might not have understood Buddha, the people who turned Buddha into an ism, maybe they were misunderstood Buddha. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Maybe those people had a misunderstanding of what Buddha was trying to say, because I don't know if Buddha was trying to make a religion. I'm almost positive he wasn't. I know Prophet Muhammad, the Holy Prophet, wasn't trying to make no religion named after himself. That wasn't a part of the revelation that came from the angel Jibril. Mm-hmm. But now you got some people that want to call themselves Muhammadans, you know what I mean? And try to make a religion out of the Holy Prophet. He didn't do that. And it goes on and on. You have a tribe of Judah from a person from the 12 tribes named Judah. Was he trying to make a religion called Judaism and just completely overlook Moses and the commandments and make a religion? You end up with Christianity. Four gospels, the synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Is it anywhere where Jesus was trying to make a religion named after himself and his title of Christ? That you go from Christ to a Christian? So once man and his misunderstanding creates religion and turns the word of God into a religion, that a word that came through the prophet of God of their choice, that is, they turn it into a religion. Once that happens, now the believers become arrogant. Mm. The believers become like a gang. And the believers want to take their gang, their spiritual gang, and make it better than somebody else's spiritual gang. We don't get involved in things like that. So you can tell that we have an understanding that was brought to us by God himself, because we never speak against these other religions, really. I mean, we put clean glass, dirty glass. We just reason with people. But we don't go out there and talk about how horrible these people are, how misinformed these people are. We don't shun our people. We receive our people regardless of what they call themselves. We have love for our people regardless of who they believe in. So if somebody wants to give me something from the Moorish Science Temple, I receive it. I accept it. You know what I mean? I'm always accepting any information that's coming from a group that represents God Himself. You know what I mean? Wherever God's name is mentioned, I'm at home. So we're not spiritually intimidated. But these groups, can't give them your literature. Mm-hmm. You can't give them a Final Call newspaper. The Final Call newspaper is telling you everyday news. Nah, I'm Christian. I don't want that. Mm-hmm. Can't say that about the Moorish American Brothers. They always receive our paper. We're mm-hmm. well received, mm-hmm. you know, there. So we want to stick right with our brothers because we want to clear up some things. You know, so we want to clear up this whole black thing because I notice with our brothers, that's where we end up. Whenever we come in contact with our brothers, they pretty much get stuck on this whole, who is the original man? The original man is the Asiatic black man. Like when brothers, you know, our brother was here. Mm-hmm. He got stuck on that word black. But in our student enrollment, I really, under the inspiration, because all of this I give credit and praise to Allah, under the spirit of Allah and under the inspiration of Allah, we kind of demonstrated how we disagree on one word, mm-hmm. which makes no sense. And that one word is not even clearly understood. You know, but in their defense, the reason they stop at that word, which a lot of them now understand that black is not a color. Black is the essence out of which all color come. Mm-hmm. But their problem is what they constantly say, and that's nationality. Black is not a nationality. Black was something that Caucasian people called us and wrote down all of these disparaging definitions behind the word black. So black is not a nation. So they look at us like, how can we legally go by that title that was given to us by them and have any leverage in society? You know what I mean? And receive anything legally from a government that doesn't respect that name or that word. That's their Bible. Mm-hmm. If I have any Moorish American brothers viewing this, he'd probably say, yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm. But he's right. But here is where we're right. See, God doesn't come to integrate us with a world that's about to be destroyed right now. So when he asked the question, who is the original man? See, this is spiritual talk. And the original man is the Asiatic black man. God is showing you the essence of life itself. It all comes from the blackness. And just like black is the father of color, we are the fathers of civilization, the fathers and the mothers of civilization. So we have a whole nother dialect, a whole nother tongue, that if your heart was right, you could receive what we're saying like they received what the apostles were saying on the day of Pentecost at Antioch. You know, we're not trying to integrate because you know why? It doesn't work. Mm-hmm. Integration doesn't work. You can learn the law and then they end up with a thing called martial law. So whatever you know, state of emergency destroys all of that. Mm-hmm. If my right is to lock my door and I know my rights, so I can have a cop knocking on my door and just go to the door and tell them, listen, if you can't produce a warrant, you can't come in. Legally, I have a right to keep my door locked and not open it up for you because you don't have a warrant. Mm-hmm. Okay? Well, that's the law. But does it work like that? Or will he break your door down? And his excuse be, martial law, state of emergency, right? Mm-hmm. Terrorism and homeland security. And he may have thought that we were in here doing something that we're not supposed to do. So that's all over. He overrides that. He busts into a person's house. That person's dead. I'm not laughing. You got to laugh to keep from crying. But what good is your knowledge then? You get pulled over. Cops do all kinds of stuff they're not supposed to do. You going to tell this cop about different codes and stuff that you know? Instead of showing that cop your license and registration when he asked for it, stepping out of the car if he asked you to, he looks at that like it's resistance. The camera shows that you won't listen, you won't comply, and now you're being shot at because he can say that you in there pulling out a gun. Mm-hmm. Turned his camera off. The only camera that's on is the police car camera, and it looks like you're resisting arrest. So we have a world today where people are so hateful, brother, and they know the future. And they know that the future doesn't have them in it, so they're trying to get you out of it. Mm-hmm. I really, really apologize for taking that long, mm-hmm. but this thing is very full, mm-hmm. you know, and okay. our people are confused. There's a tug of war contest going on with our people, and we're going to try to break the strings today.
Mm-hmm. So you said that the blackness is just it's not a color, it's the source of color.
Right.
So two questions. Why then, still then, why did the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad refer to us as black people? And then the second question is why Asiatic? So Asiatic black men, what's the significance of that terminology?
Well, like our Moorish American brothers, mm-hmm. they call us Asiatic because that's history. It's a historical term. We were Asiatic. People from Asia. You know, Asia is one of the only continents, really, that the Europeans, colonialists, they did not name that continent. You know, the European colonialists named Africa mm-hmm. Scipio Africanus. Mm-hmm. Scipio being an Italian name and Africanus being a Greek name. So the Roman, the Greco-Roman Empire always merged because the foot trail of the Europeans, of course, they were in Greece before they got to Rome. Mm-hmm. So it's the Greco-Roman. See, empire meaning you have the Romans, but what language do they speak? Before they spoke Italian, they spoke Greek. You see what I'm saying? So now here's Scipio, 135 years before Jesus, he ends up with this Greek name, and after he conquered Africa, he puts his Greek name on Africa. Because the conquering general back in those days, and before, would always get to put their name on the land that they conquered. Most of these little tribes and stuff like that, and little pieces of landmass, they're named after the people mm-hmm. that was there, like the tribe of Zebulun, the tribe of Judah, the tribe of Benjamin. These were people that had land, a tribe, mm-hmm. and that land was named after them. So after Scipio beat Hannibal, his name got put on the land that the Carthaginians occupied, which was northern Africa. Okay. See, these are facts. And we have so much more that we can agree on than disagreeing. If we could just sit down and humble ourselves and pray, like it says in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14, then God will heal our land, man. And then we can unite and get some land and get somewhere. We're not getting anywhere with all of this disunity, you know? That's the point. The conscious community is the problem. We're not going to get off that topic. No matter which way I go, we're going to come right back to this conscious community. I mean, you have the Pan-Africanists today, right? You have the Hebrew Israelites today, the Moorish Americans today. Everybody got some truth. But when you take your truth and you use it against another person that got truth, now you got the people dizzy trying to see which truth they should follow. And my little son, 17 years old, Jabril, when I was cutting his hair and, you know, right before we were going to talk with Brother Sabir, the traveling Moor, shout out to my brother, when we asked him if he had anything to say, he was talking about his young community and generation and how the older men are being confusing. With all this black and this more and this black and more stuff. Come on, man. Is it that serious? Is your difference that serious that we can't unite? Listen, if I meet a Jehovah Witness and I say, oh man, all praise is due to Allah. Oh no, his name is Jehovah. You know what we say? Yes, sir. That is definitely one of his names. Allah has many great names. See, we're always trying to do what Allah wants us to do, and that's unite with other people that are supposed to be good-spirited people, good-believing people. We're never, because of altitudes, we're taught by the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad going to speak the same language. We had one of our insane ones that got so angry that he couldn't make everybody speak the same dialect. He tried to destroy the whole world. This is the black man's history. It goes all the way back, right? 66 trillion years ago, we're taught. We still got that same spirit today, that moon god mentality, where if I say, come on out to break bread with us, brother, you know what I mean? Assalamu alaikum. Brother got a beard, it's red, he got a mark on his head because he prays. He has the jalabiya. He has the kufi. Come on out, brother. We got to get together so we can stop some of this killing, man. Our people love Islam. They would love to see us walk through the community united. Come on, let's get together and devise a plan, right? That will help us demonstrate unity so maybe the gangs can unite. When they see us, the Nation of Islam, the Sunnis or the Salafi unite. Come on, let's come to the mosque, all right? Mosque number 12. Mosque is masjid. See? So before we can even get some real work done, we arguing over the European expression of saying mosque or the Arabic expression of saying masjid. You know, and come on, we're going to come to the Moorish Science Temple. Temple, that's a school. See what I'm saying? I'm going to end again. The conscious community is the problem. Guess what? Now we can name that. We can name this one that. The conscious community is the problem.
So what's the solution then?
Well, every solution starts off with light being shined on it. The solution is sometimes when somebody is wrong, somebody got to say it. Hey, man, that's wrong. It don't stop until somebody acknowledges that that's wrong. Hey, leave that girl alone, man. You know, as soon as you bring attention to something, then whatever is happening that's not supposed to be happening, there's a pause for a minute, right? When you're doing something that ain't right and somebody call you on it, you want to see who is recognizing what you're doing. So once you shine light on it, shine light, the light of truth on falsehood, falsehood vanishes. So to bring it back to practical terms, we have to acknowledge the wrong first. We got to recognize the wrong first. And then we fix it by trying to change our attitude in the name of God, man. And God will put the love in our hearts that would have us be able to sit down and reason with each other. Conflict resolution is the answer. It's not just dealing with gangs, it's dealing with the spiritual gangs as well.
Yeah, it's all division.
Right. Because the only person that is benefiting from our divide is Satan. Yep.
That's right.
The conscious community is the problem. What is the solution? Stop being so exclusive. I mean, when are you going to take a step? When are you going to take a step towards uniting? You know what I mean? When are we going to take a step towards unity? Unity. I mean, we need a round table, bro. I don't know if you see what I see. But a round table, town hall meeting with the conscious community, not that it's never happened before, but we gotta pray, man. We gotta do what the scriptures say. I quoted the scripture, 2 Chronicles, chapter 7, verse 14. If my people who are called by my name, that's the name of the one God, would humble themselves, right, and pray and seek my face. You know, without going through the rest of that verse, we got to humble ourselves and we got to pray that God gives us the right spirit that would help us to be able to benefit from what the other man knows and not be jealous over what the other man knows. You understand what I'm trying to say? I hope that answered it. Not that we're going to stop, because I want to go into these little differences. And I'm telling you, brother, the differences is our lack of understanding. Whenever you can't connect what you know to what somebody else knows, that means you don't know what you think you know. You're not clear on your own teaching. Because God is never going to leave you in a position where you are creating confusion. Because He, God, is not the author of confusion. So He has what our spiritual or our Christian brothers would call, God has a thing, a spirit called the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit of truth pulls all truth together. And like I said earlier, we know the name of that Holy Spirit. We know the body that that Holy Spirit lives in. This is not arrogance, this is a fact. Well, how do we know that the Holy Spirit lives in the body of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan? How do we know that? Because he literally is the only man that can go anywhere in the four corners of the earth and he can speak and be well received and pull people in by the millions and not the thousands, where we will be getting millions of converts, not just thousands of converts. When you're worldwide, you know you're not going to get 5,000 converts at a time. There's a time coming where millions of people are going to come to this message. So the Jews in the scriptures, it says we must stop Jesus from doing what he's doing and teaching what he's teaching, because this Jew's talking now, 2,000 years ago, if we don't stop Jesus from teaching what he's teaching, everybody's going to follow him. That's a little more than 5,000 converts at a time. Even though it was only 5,000, or less than 5,000 people, and there wasn't even 5,000 people in that area at the time, you don't have to go into that. But I like to just throw it out there to let people know that I know that scripture is prophetic. You're never dealing with everybody when you're just dealing with Jerusalem. A little small group of the earth, or a little small piece of the earth, a little small piece of landmass on the planet. A little city. Walking distance. You don't see him catching no plane. You really don't even see him catching no boat too much. Or no ship. A little boat maybe, just to cross over a lake or a river. But ain't nobody crossing over no ocean. See? Showing you that these are signs of a greater day with a greater man. So in Orthodox Islam, or in the Holy Quran, Jesus has two jobs. One is prophet, one is Christ. The job as prophet is, of course, smaller than the Christ job. Prophet is local, Christ is global. So Jesus, the prophet, gives us the gospel in these little cities that spread out throughout the world. Later on, Prophet Muhammad, the prophet, he gives us the Holy Quran that starts off in Arabia and spreads out throughout the world. But Al-Mahdi and Al-Masih, Jesus the Christ, He's a global man. You feel where I'm coming from?
Yeah.
All praise is due to Allah. For the honor of Elijah Muhammad and the honorable minister of Farrakhan. You think I'd be saying this if it wasn't for them? Do you know why people get mad when I say that? Why don't you just talk, man? You ain't got to keep giving credit to the ministry. Why not? Where did I learn it from? Do you know Moses, when the children of Israel were thirsty? We on the internet, it's thirsty listeners, thirsty viewers. And Moses struck the rock, cracked the part of the earth with a spring of water shot out for everybody to get a drink. Of course, God was the source of that type of power. But according to the Bible scriptures, not the Holy Quran, because the Holy Quran frees the prophets up of false charges. But according to the Holy Bible, when Moses struck the rock and water sprung out of the earth, he didn't give credit to Allah. He didn't say Alhamdulillah. So when he didn't say all praise is due to Allah, that's what kept him out of the hereafter. He wasn't able to go to the promised land because of that. And Joshua was able to, he ended up having to take the children of Israel into the promised land, not Moses, because he didn't give God credit. Now, what would I look like if I'm saying all this greatness and I don't give credit to the great man that gave me this great teaching?
Right.
I want to go to the hereafter. I want to go to the promised land. I'm not doing it for just that. I'm thankful to Allah that Allah gave me the kind of mother that raised me right. I'm always going to give credit to the person who gave me life. I'm always going to recognize the person that gave me anything. And I'm going to lift his name. Because not only did God bless me, he blessed me through this person. So not only do I recognize Allah, but I recognize the vessel that Allah used to give me whatever it is that God is blessing me with. Yes, sir. All praise to you too.
So what are the divisions? You mentioned before about what to just like break some of them down.
Yes. So when I say the conscious community is the problem, look at the division with the Hebrew Israelites. Yo, man, the white man, see, Esau ain't no good, man. See, y'all ain't even the right one. Y'all ain't the chosen one. Y'all are Ishmael. See, we down with Isaac, who came from Sarah. And Sarah gave birth to the chosen seed. So we got Isaac. Y'all got Ishmael. Ishmael wasn't the chosen. This Bible don't talk about Ishmael being the chosen group of people. Yes, God blessed Hagar and gave us some land, but they ain't the chosen people. We are. So when y'all talk about Islam, I mean, it sounds good. Y'all call it God Allah. That's Elohim. That's Yahweh. That's what the chosen people call God. They weren't even allowed to speak God's name. There's reasons behind all of that. We may not be able to get into that today. But they couldn't even speak the name of God. Only in prayer would God allow them to say his name. You're the group of people that you call yourself chosen, but you don't even find out what you're chosen to do. Yeah, you're chosen. You're chosen to do what? You're chosen to be an example to people that God is focusing on in the future. You're writing scripture and showing us what not to do. Chosen man. Chosen man.
Now, you're saying this because the children of Israel were rebellious in the scripture.
Absolutely. That was their nature.
How did they rebel? What are some of the things?
Well, they did. They went against Allah. When they rebelled against the commandments of Allah. They set up many different gods. There's one God they believed in many.
And this was after Moses came to them.
Exactly. Right. Moses couldn't leave these so-called chosen people for a month before they started disobeying. You don't think God knew they were going to disobey? He chose them because he knew they were going to disobey. Let's trace it all the way back to who they say is so great, Jacob. The one that the scripture said that God loved. We talked about this before. God loved the mindset, or he loved his own permissive will. He saw Jacob being a trickster. He saw, I'm talking about God, saw Jacob in the womb. He knew these things was going to take place. He saw Jacob being a hill grabber. He saw Jacob being a supplanter. He saw Jacob tricking his brother and lying to the father, calling himself something that he wasn't. But God fell in love with his own permissive will, and he let it happen. Even though the active will said that the older one was supposed to get the blessing, right? And the birthright. The greatness, the history will be connected to this one and not the other one. But it didn't go like that because of Esau. He hated the mind of Esau. Esau, because he knew the future, his mother taught him that the old would serve the younger. Esau became greedy and wanted everything he could get, even a bowl of soup. And he would put that over the birthright. So when that took place, of course God hated that mindset that Esau had, but yet his divine will, aim, and purpose was still going to take place. So he ends up loving what he permitted to take place, and that's Jacob, to wear the name of the chosen one, or the blessed one, or the one that would get the birthright. And then Jacob ends up putting his name everywhere Esau's name is supposed to be. What does all of this mean if you don't know scripture? It means that a history was being written. It means that Caucasian people erase you from history. That's what that means. It means that when you talk about the father of medicine and you give your Hippocratic oath, it means, but it means that you ain't going to hear nothing about Imhotep. That's what it means. That all you're going to hear about is Hippocrates as the father of medicine, when he had a teacher that was black, but you don't learn about that. It means you may learn about Bill Gates being a billionaire, but you might not know about Mansa Musa, who was the ultimate billionaire. See, it means that you're not going to be written down at all. It means that a younger group of people are going to get credit for doing everything, and you will get credit for doing nothing. But at the end, the Bible says we will remove the devil's yoke from around our necks. That's what's happening today. So now that we are entering into the day that the Bible and the Holy Quran calls judgment, everything is being made to tell on itself, and that's why internet is a thorn in the side of the devil. He hates the internet. He has no control over the internet like he wants to. So he'll take the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan off of Facebook, right? Then have to put him back on because he don't like the fact that him taking the minister off doesn't stop the minister at all. So it shows how much power and how well received God's man is. So they'll act like they are putting him back on. So that they can exercise some little power and make you think, okay, they had a change of heart. We don't care what your heart is saying. The minister stands no matter what you do. The minister is on Facebook, on Instagram. Snoop Dogg said, how you gonna take the minister off of Facebook? He said, that's my dear brother. I'm going to keep posting this stuff up. He ain't by himself. You touch that man, the whole world gets upset today. That's God's man. He's no prophet. This man is a Messiah. That's not just idle words. Look at the power of the Messiah and look at his power. And you do the math.
How would you prove it?
How would I prove it? With scripture. Just read the word. Nobody. It was a much dispute over Jesus. Much dispute over Farrakhan. Is he a racist? Is he anti-Semitic? Is he this? Is he that? But nobody would speak about him openly for fear of the Jews. It's the scriptures. Is it anybody else like that? Very, very, very easy to prove. You hear what I'm saying? You have guys like Steve Harvey that at one time called the minister, the honorable minister of Farrakhan, his spiritual advisor. Have you heard Steve Harvey utter Farrakhan's name? And that's how he ended up with the Little Big Shots. That's how he ended up with the Steve Harvey Show. That's how he ended up with the Family Feud. Now, don't nitpick me and say, nah, before he said that, he already had Family Feud. Whatever it is. This man can't say Farrakhan and be successful. We know this. Not just him, but none of them. You want to be successful? Don't say Farrakhan. That goes for everybody. Barack Obama has a beautiful picture with the Honorable Menace Lord Farrakhan, right? Right. They were going through the Democratic debate, right? Whose name popped up? Farrakhan's name popped up. And he had to denounce Farrakhan to be the president of the United States. The leader of the free world had to denounce a man that they say ain't really nothing. It must be something because it took place for about 5 minutes of the debate. They talking about Farrakhan. Denounce him, reject him, and all this other stuff. A man that didn't do anything wrong. A man that I believe a president like Donald Trump will say, I don't see where this man is wrong. See, Donald Trump is like Pilate. He want to make America great again. He don't have no time to think about no religious stuff. This man ain't thinking about no Farrakhan. This man might make a deal with Farrakhan. And that's why the Jews got to keep him with a choke chain like a pit bull and keep him away from Farrakhan. Because Donald Trump's racist agenda might just work for the black man and woman. He might just be the Castro that we need. That's what the minister was saying about Reagan on the Phil Donahue show. When he was being interviewed by Phil Donahue, he said, did you vote for Reagan? You should have. No, but we sick of you. We don't want you to give us nothing but a piece of land that we can call our own and we can get away from you. And we don't even look for you to give us that. We want you to free yourself by giving us what you're supposed to give us. That's for them, not us. Because we're going to get it one way or the other. We're going to take it. It's going to be given to us by God. But if you want to vindicate yourself as being one of the worst people on the face of the earth, why don't you just do us right? So you have some Trump followers that we had the town hall meeting with Sister Ava here in Philadelphia, and she was saying how he's the type of person that might just do that. So they got to keep him under close microscope. You know he loves to deal with people that America would call enemies. America calls the minister an enemy. So they want to make sure you don't stumble up on that enemy and start finding out how great the minister is. I talked to the minister, he's great. You know, Omarosa got fired, didn't she? She was on one of them little talk shows. And she said Trump meets with all the black leaders. And they said, look who he's meeting. He's meeting people that ain't really nothing. Meeting Steve Harvey and stuff. Who is he? Is he a black leader? Or are you a black man doing good? There ain't no leader just because you're doing good. You meeting with Kanye West, is he a black leader or is he a rapper? He a black rapper. That ain't really meeting no black leader. She said, well, who do you think would be a credible leader for Donald Trump to meet with, and the person was interviewing her said, Farrakhan, I don't want it so Farrakhan. He had never met him. She said, well, we're working on that right now. Woo-wee. The whole earth shook, and they grabbed Donald Trump, and next thing you know, he was turning Israel into the capital. Somehow the Jews got this pilot and was able to force this pilot of today to do what they wanted him to do. Just like the Jews of yesterday manipulated Pilate to kill Jesus. You're living the scriptures. Very, very easy to prove. I don't want to keep going because we don't have the time. But it's very, very easy to prove that the minister is who he says he is.
Save some of that for next time.
Yes, sir.
You have anything you want to close out with?
Well, I want to get back to the conscious community being a problem. And we can close out with that. If I tell you the truth, man, we might as well rock out. If you think about it, you know I'm not done cutting your hair yet. And our people should be mature enough to be able to just have enough patience to sit through and get the whole thing. I don't know the time limit right now, but I can close out with this. The conscious community being the problem. You talked about one of the things that we have a problem with. We talked about the Hebrew Israelites who call the Caucasian people Esau. And that does not fit. So now here we have a dilemma. We need a round table sit down discussion over their doctrine and ours. But we must open up in prayer and humble ourselves and ask God to iron out our differences so we can see just what the truth really is. And if you have any God in you at all, you should be able to see what God is forcing you to see. Scriptures, in other words, we need Amos's plumb line to see if your interpretation lines up. And if it's crooked, then that means you gotta throw it away, man. So we can agree on the main source of life itself, and that's God and a clear understanding of God. See, we don't have to argue over names when you call them what you want. Quetzalcoatl, you want to call them Jesus, Jesus, call them what you want. Isa, call them what you want. But what is he teaching? Because he is the way to God. So we want a clear way to God. So the only way we're going to get that is if we stop talking about people and backbiting. Backbiting means I'm biting your back. Backbiting means I'm not standing in front of you and dealing with you the way I should. You know what I mean? We believe this, and we believe that this is the truth. And we don't believe what you have, brother, is the truth. So we want to sit down and reason with you. This is what we should be hearing. Not, they not real Muslims. So we're going to deal with those, that group of conscious community. Where's the beards? They believe that God came and God is a man. They don't even say it right. They say we believe that Allah is Master Farah Muhammad. When did we say that? When did we say that? What book do we have that say that? Point number 12, they have a problem with it. Does point number 12 say that? We don't have to go into it, but it doesn't say that. It calls Master Prophet Muhammad what the Holy Prophet Muhammad calls the man that comes in the last days. It calls him the Mahdi. So we don't have to go into that again, but we can have a table talk or a town hall meeting or a round table discussion so we can get on the same page. That's one group. Then our beautiful Moorish American brothers, because they have good spirits out of all the groups that we talk to. They come to our meetings, we go to theirs. I love those brothers' spirit because they all about the people, it seems like. The people that come under Noble Drew Ali. But what's their dilemma? Nationality, like we said earlier. You know what I mean? Let's have a sit-down discussion. Because they think when we call ourselves Moors, we're going to be all right. See, you want to talk about that. We're not going to be all right if we call ourselves Moors. I don't care what you call yourself. This man wants you dead. Come on, man. We gotta use common sense today. Law helps when you're trying to integrate. God wants to separate us from our enemies, not integrate us with our enemies based on the knowledge that we have. So that's why our language is different. We want to talk about that. So the Hebrew Israelite brothers, Esau is the older brother. We are older people, so you can't call white people Esau. He's Jacob. He's the trickster. He's the supplanter. He's the hill grabber. Genesis, Moses called him the hill biter, the hill bruiser. And we're here to bruise his head with truth. So let's sit down at the round table so we can bruise the head of the serpent. That's my final point.
Okay, my brother.
You don't have nothing else?
That's pretty good, brother.
We good?
Yes, sir.
All praise due to Allah till we meet again.
Okay, so I'll
thank you. Thank you, Salah.
For the last special.